Well, thanks for that introduction. This is supposed to be an author chat. So last night we did a formal presentation. Today we're chat, and we probably can take questions as we go on if we have them. And I just have notes that I'm going to go on. I'm not going to, not a great script. But I mean, the starting point of where this issue has gotten attention recently was Disney. The New York Times had reported that Disney fired 250 American computer programmers down in Orlando, and then had them train their foreign replacements using the H-1B visa program. You may have just heard the news now is that all the lawsuits in regard to that have been ended, that because what Disney did is perfectly legal. It is legal to replace Americans with H-1B workers. So, and the Disney thing actually occurred while we were writing the book, so it was kind of timely to promote the book, but it happened while we were doing things. So, we'll start with a little bit of a history of immigration law in the United States, and then I'm going to go to my personal story here. The current immigration system started in 1952. We passed the Immigration and Nationality Act of 1952, which created the current immigration system. And in that act, Congress got rid of everything that existed before and then created an entirely new system. So it was comprehensive immigration reform, as how the term is in literal English, as opposed to what we call comprehensive immigration reform now, which is just make the system more complicated to benefit lawyers. In the Immigration Act of 1952, there were two guest worker visas. It was called the H-1 visa and the H-2 visa. The H-1 visa was for people of distinguished ability. So the expectation this was going to be like Nobel Prize winners, distinguished researchers, and that kind of thing. And H-2 was absolutely everything else. And what happened to derail the system is a common problem we'll be talking about more in the second half presentation, is administrative abuse. Because what under the H-1 program, there were no protections for American workers. As Congress, they documented in their reports that it didn't make any sense to have protection for American workers when we're inviting researchers and Nobel Prize winners and that type of person. So the H-1 visa had no protections for American workers. What the INS started doing was treating anyone in a profession as having distinguished ability. Engineers, computer programmers were being admitted under the H-1 program when they should have been required to go through the H-2 program, which actually had stronger protections than any of the current visas. So that brings us, we'll now skip from 1952 all the way to 1990, which we can skip all the other things. And in 1990, we had the Immigration Act of 1990, which is, when you hear people talk about our broken immigration system, the Immigration Act of 1990 was largely responsible for breaking it. That was the act that created the H-1B visa. That was supposed to deal with this problem of people coming on going on H-1 visas when they were supposed to come on H-2 visas. But rather than taking the normal rational step of just redefining what distinguished ability meant and clarifying it so that the INS couldn't be just letting computer programmers come in without any worker protections, the Immigration Act of 1990 just made a complete tangle of the immigration system and created the H-1B visa for specialty occupations, which means anything that requires a college degree. And so you have to have it, so that can cover a wide variety, computer programmers, physical therapists, all kinds of things like that. But things became much more complicated. We created visa categories for all kinds of different purposes in that act. And so it had the main effect of creating jobs for immigration lawyers. Okay. So after creating this visa and making things much more complicated in 1990, in 1994, the AIG in New Jersey, near where I live, and Sealand became the first to use the H-1B program to replace American workers. They contracted foreign vendors to bring in H-1B workers into the United States, and they had them, at AIG, they fired 250 Americans and replaced them with H-1B workers. And at Sealand, they fired 350 Americans and replaced them with H-1B workers. Okay, and what they did is by using an intermediary, like AIG used the company called Syntel to buy the workers. AIG could say, "Well, we didn't get any H-1B visas." Syntel could say, "We didn't get any. We didn't fire any Americans, so the law wasn't broken," and they exposed a gaping loophole in the law. In regard to H-1B.